The mitral valve is the valve that's between the collecting chamber on the left side of the heart, where the blood comes from the lungs and goes into the left ventricle. The left ventricle is the main pumping chamber of the heart. So if you have a problem with your mitral valve, then you either have leaking that goes back into the atrium and thus into the lungs when the heart contracts, or mitral stenosis, a narrowing of the mitral valve, which is less common, certainly in the United States, would impede blood flow from the collecting chamber into the ventricle. The most common symptom of a patient that has mitral valve disease is shortness of breath. So it typically would start when they exert themselves. But, you know, fatigue and tiredness is something that people over a period of time would describe. There's a small percentage of patients that have mitral valve problems where it happens suddenly or acutely due to a heart attack or something else, and they would have very sudden shortness of breath. But the average patient that has a leaking mitral valve would have no symptoms for a prolonged period of time, and then over a slow period of time would develop increasing shortness of breath with exertion. The common cause that we see is from a floppy or a prolapsing mitral valve. Most of those can be repaired. So most floppy mitral valves in an experienced mitral valve center can be repaired. Now, that having been said, there certainly are some patients who have more severe disease of the valve if they've had infection of the valve or rheumatic fever who need a valve replacement. And the good news there is that a very good second choice is a valve replacement. We have a couple of options in the United States, and one would be a mechanical heart valve, which is typically a tilting disc mechanical valve. That would require blood thinners. And the other would be a tissue heart valve. A pig valve is a typical example of that. So the bottom line is that in the vast majority of patients, we try to repair your own mitral valve, which means that the patient does not have to be on a blood thinner, and the valve should have excellent long-term freedom from problems. So if you have a mechanical valve, we would typically put a mechanical valve in a younger person, and the reason, especially in the mitral position as opposed to the aortic valve position, because tissue heart valves, like a pig valve in the mitral position, can wear out over time. So they become calcified as the years go by. So after 10, 15, certainly by 20 years, there's a very reasonable chance that the valve could have degenerated some and require another operation. On the other hand, mechanical heart valves do not wear out. So mechanical heart valves, certainly the ones that are implanted in the United States, have never had a mechanical failure in millions of implants. So the only reason a mechanical heart valve would ever need to come out would be that it got infected, which is rare but can happen, or it got clot on it. So then that can happen if patients have problems with their anticoagulation. Again, those are unusual circumstances. But mechanical heart valves are also a very reasonable option for a young person if they do not have a repairable valve. Most commonly, the mitral valve itself has two leaflets to it, and those two leaflets are supposed to close when the heart contracts. One of those leaflets will prolapse and the blood will leak back into the atrium. So the operation consists of typically going through a sternotomy incision. We usually make a small sternotomy incision. Patients are put on a heart-lung bypass machine, so that's required to go inside the heart to do the repair. We approach the mitral valve through the atrium, that's the collecting chamber of the heart, and we have an excellent view of the valve through the atrium. Typically, in order to repair a floppy valve, we do a couple of things. One is, when we have one of those leaflets, which we've described as prolapsing, we remove a segment of that prolapsing leaflet and the attached chordae, which are the struts that hold that valve. We suture the other parts back together, and then we typically put a ring that goes around the annulus of the valve, because what happens when patients have mitral regurgitation is that annulus of the valve increases in size over time. We need to bring it back down to normal size so that those leaflets can close on themselves. So those are the two most common things we need to do to repair a floppy valve. Also, there are times when we actually replace those struts, those cords, with artificial cords, which are typically a Gore-Tex type suture like you see in a rain jacket. And those work very nicely in the long term to support the valve. So with those three techniques, that should allow us to repair about 98% of the type of valve problems that we see in patients that have floppy valves. Your average person that has it would require a stay of 4 or 5 days in the hospital with 1 day in intensive care. There are no doubt that some patients are ready to leave by 3 days after surgery, and others may need 5 or 6, but I'd say 4 or 5 is a typical stay. Usually by 2 or 3 weeks after surgery, they're starting to get back to their routine activities. There are, if you take all patients that have mitral repair in my experience, I'd say that, you know, maybe 20 to 30% of them will say right away, oh, I'm breathing better. But there's probably a good subset of the other patients who it really takes them 3 or 4 months to actually notice a significant difference in their breathing. And I always mention that to patients. Some very high quality papers which would suggest that a surgeon should do at least 10 to 15, and certainly obviously if you do more, mitral valve repairs per year to have good long-term results. So that would suggest that the majority of these type of repairs should be done in a center that does a fair number of mitral repairs like our center. The good news is that at a center like this that has experience doing mitral repairs, that the success rate is greater than 99% of the patient having an excellent result without having a significant complication.